Good evening, everyone, and super excited to be here. This is episode 3 of Speciale Talks, brought to you by Speciale Invest. We're an early stage seed fund focused on enterprise software SaaS companies and frontier tech startups in software and hardware, writing check sizes up to $500,000, sometimes slightly higher in very, very early stages of a company, right? Built out of Chennai and Bangalore, right? Focusing on very interesting companies across the deck, right? Today's focus is understanding the sales tech SaaS landscape across the software SaaS ecosystem, right? And we have three amazing early stage founders joining us today to share their experiences, right? And to share their journey and talk about what's happening in this ecosystem. Where are we today, right? And where is this going to go in the next few years, right? We'll draw upon their learnings of what they're building. We'll draw upon their experiences of seeing competitive landscape globally as well as coming out of India. And we will see what the trends are in this broad ecosystem. Very, very exciting domain in terms of sales tech SaaS, right? And we'll spend the next 1 hour talking about this stage. And then we'll open it up to questions from the audience to also maybe talk another 20 minutes or so, right? With that in mind, let's get started. Introducing our panelists today, Shruti Kapoor, founder, CEO at Wingman. Disclaimer, one of the companies building intelligence AI for sales reps to use platforms to enable to sell better. Voice intelligence, Venkat Krishnaraj, founder at Clenty, right? That enables sales by bunch of automation and personalization tools. Right, building this company out of Chennai, bootstrapped, if I may say so, right, which is rare to see in this ecosystem, but very exciting to learn from that part of your experience as well. Welcome, Venkat.
Thanks, Arjun.
Sridhar, a dear friend and somebody I've known for many years, welcome as well. Co-founder, CEO at B2Brain, building sales intelligence provided for sales teams to be better prepared, to reach out to customers better and to enable better output on sales closures, right? He's been a SaaS veteran, SaaS slash enterprise software veteran over the years in the Indian ecosystem. So lovely to have you here, Sridhar, and learn from you as well.
Thanks, Arjun. Hi, Shruti and Venkat.
Good. We'll get started by, you know, broadly talking about, you know, the background of this ecosystem. Right, we've seen an emergence of sales tech tools and SaaS platforms over, I think, the last 5 years. Of course, we all know the behemoth that is there, which is Salesforce, that has been around a much longer time. But it seems like that's a company that has also enabled, right, an ecosystem of companies to come through, right, by creating a platform or a marketplace of sorts, right. And in the last 5 years, we are seeing an emergence of tools that enables sales teams, sales organizations to perform better at various levels, right? And I have seen this segmentation or sub-segmentation of this category in various ways, right? There is sales enablement, there is sales education, sales coaching, there is sales intelligence, there is sales automation, right? And a couple of other sub-segments, right? And each of these segments seem to have effectively actually hundreds of companies as I see it. I think there is one of these maps that we've all seen, right? And probably is there in most of our decks, right? That talks about the emergence of these sectors. I think 2-3 years ago, I saw this this map to have 3 subsegments. Now I see it to have 5 subsegments, right? And each of them is getting more dense in terms of how many companies are there, right? And now, of course, we've also had in the last couple of years, maybe 3 years, a bunch of unicorns that have been coming up, right? So I just want to open up top to the, you know, speakers, first of all, to introduce themselves, quick overview of where they come from, what they're building, and then talk a couple of minutes about what they're seeing in the ecosystem, what their view is, why is this happening, right? Shruti, if we can start with you.
Sure. Hi, everyone. So just, I think, continuing from what Arjun mentioned, right? So with Wingman, when we started building it out, the main problem that we were looking to solve was the quality of data that existed in the CRM, right? The big challenge used to be that the only way data made its way into the CRM was a person manually putting it in. And that meant that, you know, you had incomplete data, you had all sorts of inaccuracies. Typically, you know, 5% of any sales interaction, like a call or a meeting, would actually make its way as a point or notes into the CRM. All right, so that's where we started. And over a period of time, we have evolved into not just providing better data capture and analytics, but also the ability to act on the insights that we see in real time. So that's what Wingman does. It's really meant to be Wingman for salespeople. You know, continuing on to the trends that we are seeing, right? So I think one trend, like I mentioned, is people have tried to always think about what is missing in Salesforce and use that as a starting point to say, okay, what does Salesforce not do? And therefore, you know, what is the opportunity there? Right. So in some sense, the whole trend of saying capture is broken. So how can we improve data capture kind of started. And then there was that, okay, now there is too much data, so you can't make sense of it. So how do you help people make sense of it? Right. And then there was still, you know, you still needed someone to kind of take those insights and act on them. And that's kind of one trend that we see, which is, I think, basically going from capture to action. I think, and I'm sure, you know, the other panelists here have other things to add to how the ecosystem has evolved. But as a broad trend, maybe two things to keep in mind for anyone who is, you know, either thinking about sales tech as a space that they are interested in as, you know, an entrepreneurship opportunity, or you know, just thinking about tools directionally is one. I would say in a lot of ways, B2B slowly and with a time lag mirrors what we see in B2C. Right. So in some sense, we've all seen how B2C purchasing has evolved. Right. Today, you go to a Google and you or you go to an Amazon and, you know, you go ahead and do your research and buy the product that you need. And the question remains, you know, will B2B evolve that way? Where will it pause? And we're already seeing companies being built in that space, right? Like Vendor, et cetera. Then the second part of it is, will, and it's somewhat related to the first, which is, do you need salespeople? And will sales get automated? And will I be talking to a bot when I actually want to purchase something? So I think those two are kind of the big directional bets that people are making. In some sense, I think the latter is probably, you know, if it happens, it's probably still some time away. But, you know, we'll definitely start seeing a lot more of the vendor type of things.
Interesting, very interesting. With that, I'll go to Venkat. Venkat, are you taking the sales guy out of the equation? Right, and throw some light on what you're building and how you see the ecosystem.
Sure. So I'm Venkat, one of the founders of Clenty. So Clenty is a sales engagement software. Actually, I think sales engagement as a category itself is getting defined, you know, in the last couple of years, the last few years. But essentially what, as a category, we do is, you know, if you're a sales rep in a B2B enterprise or B2B, you know, sales team, you know, we help you send emails, make calls, automated outreach via social media and so on to connect with your prospects. So when you have a lead that comes in or a lead that's assigned to you, you need to set up a meeting, book a call with that person, and then, you know, get on the sales conversation. We help in that process, automating, improving your efficiency, and, you know, working as a layer on top of your CRM. So the thesis, sort of when we got started with this product, when we were working on this opportunity, was, you know, as sales reps, and not just sales, I think today everybody spends their entire, you know, working day in front of some software, right? So we log in the morning and we, you know, look into some software and spend the entire day on that software. And for sales reps, they tend to typically be either on their CRM or on some sort of a communication tool. So they're on Gmail or, you know, making some calls, or they're in the CRM, you know, updating records and so on. So our view was, you know, email is still very general purpose, you know, meant for large scale normal use, not the sales use case. And then, you know, people are on CRM juggling the two. What if we could redefine and create a communication platform for salespeople that just automates a lot of the things that they do? And that's sort of the idea or thesis how we started. What we're seeing, though, right, and it's interesting to see how this industry has evolved in the last few years, and in terms of how the buyer behavior or, you know, the purchase journey of the buyer is evolving. So earlier, you know, the vendors used to hold a lot of the cards. So people selling, you know, the software, you know, they would decide how they qualify you and how they engage with you and so on. But today it is, you know, the sort of balance of power has shifted significantly on the side of the buyer. You know, it doesn't matter what you're selling, what kind of a salesperson you are, but the buyer controls a lot of the, you know, when they choose to get on a call with you, when they decide to speak to your salesperson, etc. A lot of that is determined because there's just a profusion of software available, profusion of, you know, vendors available for every category. So in that, so, you know, for example, if you look at G2 Crowd, they say 90% of research is actually done before you engage with the salesperson. And our job is to help salespeople, you know, engage with prospects and get on a call with prospects. So which means the bar to getting on a call is much higher these days. You know, 5 years ago when we started this product, or 4 years ago, people used to say, you know, send 4 follow-up emails, send 5 follow-ups, etc. Then they said, you know, 10, send, you know, you need to do 10, 12 follow-ups. Today they're saying 17, 18 follow-ups to get on a call with the salesperson, or, you know, get on a call with the prospect, which means you have to do more as a salesperson to be able to get that meeting, to be able to talk to that prospect. So what we are trying to do is actually trying to bring that number down. So we are saying, how can we be intelligent, you know, and not send the same message to everybody, be more intelligent about what message you send to the right person, try and identify intent, and, you know, focus selectively on the people who are ready to buy, so nurture the people who are not yet ready to buy, and so on. So that's sort of the approach that we are taking, which is, you know, the 17 calls shouldn't become 25 calls and 35, you know, follow-ups before you can book a meeting. But how do we bring this down so that you're able to do this in a easier and, you know, help the people who need help at this point?
Very interesting. Very interesting. I think you mentioned the point of how do you prepare and get yourself more ready to talk to the customer and maybe not having to do 15 outreaches, right? Sridhar, I'm sure you have deep insights on that front. Right. Given what you're building at B2Brain, please spend some time talking about B2Brain and how do you see this part of preparation for a salesperson being done?
Yeah, thanks, Arjun. I'm really building B2Brain so that B2Brain has more insights than I do. That will be helpful for the salespeople also, a lot more of them. So the core problem that we saw, which kind of pushed us into building B2Brain, was this. Despite the profusion of sales tech stack, and, you know, as Venkat rightly mentioned, salespeople today are predominantly remote. Even if you tell a customer, I'm coming to meet you, they'll say, don't come. Okay. So they would rather do it on Zoom rather than, you know, than in person. And despite the fact that they were equipped with amazing software, okay, I mean, sales tech is like really taken off, right? And I would imagine Shruti can probably appreciate this. You know, in the last 1.5 years of evolution, I'm sure your tech has like dramatically scaled up, right? So all of this has taken place. But yet it seems that salespeople still spend between 30 to 40% of their time going through Google searches and going through LinkedIn Navigator to figure out what's going on in a company before they go and reach out to that company, okay? If you think about the amount of time and effort that salespeople spend looking through all this disparate information in a fairly inefficient way, Google's not best suited for B2B searches, okay? It's a colossal waste of time and energy and money for the company, okay? So our whole problem was, if you are selling security software, for example, you're looking for specific types of signals from a prospect in order to go and engage with them with a very compelling message. If you're selling supply chain, you're looking for a different set of signals. Maybe there's an overlap, but depending on the nature of your business, you're always looking for specific things. Okay. So if we could prepare and figure out what those specific signals are you looking for to aid your business with the prospect and deliver it to you within your CRM or your sales workflow engine, say Clenty, for example, or, you know, Outreach Salesloft, any of these, your messaging gets far more relevant. Your talk tracks and preparation can be dramatically better. So that was the whole, you know, thought process behind B2Brain. It is designed to fit in your workflow, give you insights where you need them, pertaining to your business and connecting with the context of your prospect. Right. So even the name was, you know, just a quick detour. The name was because, you know, it's like it has to function like your brain, not in front of you, but doing all the work and coming back and giving you what is necessary at the right point in time. And we only focus on B2B outbound sales and ABM teams. Okay, that's the only group which we believe we are best suited for. So that's the, That's the origin of the. Did I get an echo? Okay. So that's the origin and the journey of the product. There were a few things we learned along the way. I'll just share a couple. One of them that we've seen is that today lots of salespeople are working remotely. Okay. And they organize their workspace and their tool stack around what makes them most productive. So while a company typically says, here is the stack in which you work, you know, your sales engagement platform, your CRM, your voice analytics, you know, they will say, let's have Clinty as your, you know, sales engagement platform. Let's have Wingman as your voice analytics, and let's have Salesforce as your CRM. There are almost always other additional small tools that they will use, which make them far more productive. Okay, so that's one trend we saw, which seems fairly consistent across several people. And B2Brain tends to get adopted as part of that. Okay, so when somebody uses it, they are able to cut down the time they spend on Google and potentially on LinkedIn as well. That's one part. The second thing that we have seen is that because there is this more power to the individual, the bottom-up selling process becomes a very interesting go-to-market strategy. Okay, it becomes so, and your product has to do the speaking for you. Okay, you can only sell so much. Your product has to work well for the salespeople because they live month to month, quarter to quarter. Okay, it's very easy for them to make a decision to buy a tool, but it's also equally easy for them to chop it off. Okay, which means, as Venkat mentioned earlier, right, the bar to acquire a salesperson as a customer has also gone up. Right, which is interesting. Basically, both of these are indicators that there is more power to the individual in the B2B world today. Right. Yeah.
Interesting. Yeah. No, very relevant points. And thank you for sharing that. Right. I'm picking up on two points, you know, from the speaker so far. One, you know, buyer behavior and style of working changing. Right. Obviously, inherently changing, more technology, more tools, etc. But there's also this last 12 months phenomena of what has happened to the world, right? And you've been forced to go remote in some sense, right? And the second part, which I think Sridhar just referred to, which is, you know, in SaaS parlance, we call product-led growth, you know, marketing-led growth, you know, bottom-up adoption, right? And we were talking about this behind, you know, backstage just before we went live also. I think a couple of you were mentioning of how your usage get adopted, right? Maybe each of you can talk about that for a little bit about your product, right? How does this change from, you know, we talk about SMB versus mid-market versus enterprise, right? I'm still of the opinion of the thinking that, you know, enterprise sales is still very different, right? You yourself are selling to, you know, enterprise sales teams, right? What is your sales process looking like? And therefore, you know, how does that tie into this entire phenomena that is happening, that change that is happening? Right.
Should we
start with you?
Yeah. It's funny, you know, when Sridhar, you were mentioning, right, like, you know, that people need to spend all this time doing research. I was just thinking that bar has been going up. You know, there used to be a point in time when if you got an email which said your first name, you would be like, oh, great. You know, they've written this email to me. And then you're like, oh, this is all just mail merge. And then, you know, you said, oh, if they've used a personalized intro line, then maybe they've done this for you. And I think what we have seen in the last 1 year is, you know, all of these video messages where, you know, people kind of figured that video is probably the thing that you can convince somebody that, you know, this is really personalized for you. And then you had like a whole wave of companies which could also mass personalize video. And then I think the biggest, in some sense, challenge and fun of selling to sales teams is the fact that they are most abreast with all of these trends. Which means that it's the audience that is hardest to surprise, right? You can no longer get away with any type of tricks when you're trying to sell to salespeople because they are ahead of the curve on those things, right? So when we first started sending out, you know, videos for prospecting during the pandemic, you know, our first few videos got like great responses, like, you know, some videos were viewed like 20 times and we were all excited. And then we realized that they were being viewed so many times because people were sharing it internally with their team and saying, hey, we should be doing something similar. And we actually got those type of responses from the sales leaders saying, hey, you know what? I really like your prospecting approach. I'm going to get my team to do the same. they might or might not buy the product, but they'll appreciate a good outreach. So I think that's definitely one thing to keep in mind, which is I think when you're selling, especially to sales and marketing, what you say is not just being judged on, you know, its own merit, but also, you know, it's being judged on many other criteria. And I think that's one aspect of it. And then I think as you go from selling to enterprises, to smaller companies, et cetera, you know, again, these behaviors vary a lot, right? So when, you know, recently we put a second button on our website, right? So we only used to have a book a demo button. And then after some debate, we decided that we'll also offer a free trial button on the website. And, you know, we had all sorts of bets internally to say, you know, what would be the ratio of people who click on one or the other, right? And, you know, everybody on the tech part of the business was like, of course, everybody just wants a free trial. Nobody wants to speak to a salesperson. I think what we see on a consistent basis is that 2/3 of the leads come in to book a demo and 1/3 of the leads come in to take a free trial. And barring one exception, we've literally never seen a large team go directly to, you know, a free trial. So I think that's the other thing to kind of keep in mind as you think about the split, which is what is their expectation. And as we deal with larger teams, today we are also learning that they'll also ask you for things like proposals, which we are almost not that familiar with.
Interesting. So Shruti, I'm just paraphrasing a little bit to say, therefore, it seemingly looks like Wingman's focus is mid-market to enterprise as opposed to SMB, small business, yeah. Right? And therefore, maybe that is also bearing on how many people are booking a demo versus how many people are self-trying. And I also was thinking on the same lines, or at least in the lines to say, we do dev tools and those other SaaS tools where it seems like, you know, developers are just lapping up. Everything is a free trial, go from freemium to this thing. I was wondering if that holds true for the sales audience as well. I think the answer is it depends, is what I'm at least beginning to hear, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Venkat, your thoughts on this, right? You've been running this for a while. What have you seen? What is your adoption pattern look like? And maybe if you can also compare that to how it was 2 years ago to today, are you seeing a stark difference given COVID and in general the evolution? How do you think about that, right? And then maybe from your lens, how do you start defining SMB? What is SMB? What is mid-market? What is enterprise?
Sure. So yeah, I think, you know, when Shruti was talking about this, you know, race to personalization with, you know, the word I use internally is there is an arms race on. Right. When it comes to, you know, how much can you up the ante when it, you know, in showing that you're really sending a personalized signal. So I think that's been going on for the last few years. And, you know, we are contributors to that. And, you know, products like us help in, you know, running that. But from a sales motion point of view, or in terms of a GTM, you know, approach point of view, right? So we are sort of in the more product / marketing led GTM approach. So like Shruti mentioned, we were the exact opposite. So we started with the start free trial button, and then the book a demo is the afterthought, right? So start free trial, you know, vast majority of our signups today are in the free trial, you know, try, use the product, set it up, see if it satisfies your workflow, and then, you know, purchase kind of this thing. So significantly self-serve. And I think similarly about 1/3 maybe, or maybe 1/4 of our leads would currently be, you know, the people who book a demo and would like to, you know, understand the product first before they actually start the evaluation process. But significant, I think I would say 3/4 is currently in the self-serve sign up.
If I may ask here, was this conscious choice right at the beginning that this is what makes sense? This is the segment that you had identified. Just talk us through a little bit of that thought process and background of why this is the case in your
life. Right. So our, you know, in some ways we were inspired by the models of Freshworks, Zoho, etc. So the idea was, you know, those are the business models that had worked. So we didn't want to reinvent the business model in terms of doing enterprise led sales from India. So we said, you know, let's figure out how this inbound, you know, so we learned from folks like Kissflow and, you know, people at that point, and said, let's figure out how to sell it at a price point, at a free trial experience and a product led experience that can be solved from here. So that was how we started. And it was a conscious choice to go that path rather than do the enterprise upmarket kind of an approach. Right. And of course, since then, as a product, we've slowly been moving upmarket. So when we started off, a $30 client would be a big client. You know, today we've gone many, many, times that, or, hundreds of times that. So we've gone into, people using up to, 100, 150 seats with us, salespeople with us and so on. So that's sort of, we're expanding in terms of the number of people. But what has worked very well for us, or, the model that we continue to follow, is the land and expand model. So people talk, it's a very bottoms up led model. A couple of salespeople start, and then that slowly expands, and then another team adds, and more people get added, and so on. And, it sort of organically grows. The volume at least grows organically. The only upsell that we do is in terms of plans or features or different plans. But the expansion itself happens quite naturally and, organically within the enterprise. And then within this, we've also put in various product-led growth type of initiatives as well, where there's a lot of feature gates, natural transitions from one feature to, where they can see the benefit of other features they are missing out within the app and stuff like that. So that's been sort of the model for the way we have grown as a company. I think when it comes to COVID impact, right? So when COVID initially happened, I think there was for a couple of months, there was a lot of uncertainty in terms of how this would evolve, and we were all prepared for the worst. But very soon, I think once people sort of settled in their remote workplaces and at home, I think slowly business went back to normal for us. And because the salespeople, they still have targets to meet. So I think it was sort of binary. So certain industries were heavily impacted. So those industries, obviously, we lost customers and so on. But the rest of the industries, where the industry level, there was no impact, salespeople went back to normal, selling behavior. Business had to get done. You also saw some shift from people who usually would be doing field sales, feet on street sales, etc., moving into an inside sales kind of a model, where they would need to use technology tools to, adopt and, expand their this thing. So those are some of the trends that we saw happening. And overall, I think now we're sort of back to much, I would say, even a stronger position than one was pre-COVID as an industry growth.
Amazing, amazing to hear that, and good to see that that product-led growth and marketing-led growth, as you say, inspired, like you said, from some of the biggies that have shown the way over the last 10 years. We've all learned from, and that's the Indian startup ecosystem in that way, only getting learning more from all of you guys as well, right? So that's very interesting. Sridhar, your thoughts on this transition, right? You still early days, I would say, the first couple of years, the COVID time, what transition did you see from your prior persona, right? What were they expecting from you? Did you change your mindset of where you wanted to focus on, size of teams you wanted to sell to, the type of companies you wanted to sell to, right? Just walk us through a little bit of that COVID impact and that transition, so to speak, and where are you today?
Yeah. So we actually launched B2Brain in the market and started testing with a few customers in Jan of last year. Okay, Jan to March, traffic kept picking up and up. And by today last year, COVID was announced and whatever lockdowns were announced, and traffic just tanked. Okay, it literally kind of went down. It was like the
pretty much precisely today, by the way. Precisely today, 12 years ago, as far as I
exactly. It's like the 1 year anniversary of.
Yes,
traffic tank. Anyway, so that happened, and then we said at least until that point in time, we had received wonderful feedback from users who were using the product. Okay, there was very high usage, and our first focus was to really crystallize what exactly is the value a user derives by using the product. Okay. Obviously, we were much, much earlier in the journey than, say, Shruti and Venkat at that point in time, right? So our first focus was to really nail what exactly is the value a user got out of us, out of using us. So we even did a launch in Product Hunt like a month later, sometime in mid-April, which again brought back a lot of usage and feedback and stuff from people. So broadly, the DNA of the team is a lot more user-centric. Okay, so there is a general inclination to do it user first and then think about the company. Okay, even from a go-to-market standpoint, right? And because the underlying thesis was that people build companies. Okay, that has always remained with us. Okay, so company is more a procedural thing of, you know, how do you actually make the sale happen? And how do you make sure the value of the sale is sufficient enough to justify the process and the cost? But so it used to be that we were dabbling with like single user, you know, subscription plan, monthly payment, all of like a whole bunch of things. So there was a lot of iteration and experimentation between, I would say, April and July, August. Okay. During the period we learned, this is last year, during the period, what we learned is, at least until end of, I would say end of June, the sales world was in a flux. Because traditionally, when a company is not doing well, the company chops off sales force. Because they think of sales as like a operating expense, not as people investment. Okay, that tends to be the mindset in several companies. Okay, and I'm not here judging companies. They do what they do. But even though people would say, look, I love the product, I think I could use it, but I don't have the budget because my job is on the line, we could relate to what they were going through, right? But as Venkat mentioned, once the initial 100 days of COVID kind of settled down, like the second half of last year, companies started figuring out and saying, look, you got to roll up our sleeves and make things happen. Okay. Once they started saying that, they started figuring out how the sales team is going to be equipped. So remote sales became very, very normal. Lots of communities got formed. Incredible. I mean, Shruti was mentioning prior to the talk about RevGenius, right? There are like probably like 20 different communities, SD Ready, SDR Nation, and like a whole bunch of stuff. And these communities were predominantly formed in the SDR world, SDR BDR world, which is really the top of the funnel for a company, for a B2B company, right? They do have fairly tough jobs every day, right? Making like, you know, 50, 100 calls and getting like three connects and one conversation and like 97 rejects and stuff is not a trivial thing, right? Their conversion is as good as Google Ads. Think about it, right? So it's a different world altogether. And because of these communities, I believe these people kind of started banding together and working together and supporting each other across companies. Huge support across companies, right? I would go into the RevGenius Slack channel and post a message, and within about half an hour, there'll be 15 people responding. I don't even know any of them. Okay, it's incredible. So clearly, that's one of the things we learned, right? There is power in the individual and there is power in the community. Okay, and they're all going to be remote for a while to come. So we said, look, you somehow have to make sure the individual sees value, because if they saw value, word spread. Okay, RevGenius was the water cooler for the entire sales community, literally, right? They didn't have a water cooler within the company, but they had one for the entire fraternity, so to say. Okay, so it was very clear that the path to a company will be by somebody trying it out and saying good words about us internally. The second thing that we saw was that teams were making decisions. It didn't have to be corporate. Okay, like one team, the SDR team will find value because two, three people in the SDR team found value, and the SDR manager will reach out and say, look, I want to use your product, and then say, you know, present, give us a team plan. Of course, they'll ask for some nature of a proposal, but not something as extensive as an enterprise would typically want. They'll want how many people, you know, what price point, what's your support level, and some basic stuff, right? Because they were looking at it and saying, if two, three people found value with your product, how can I equip everybody in my team to find value? Okay, so that was very clear. Okay, and so we broke down the problem of selling to the enterprise as selling to teams. Okay, and not necessarily to the entire enterprise. Because what subsequently happened, so as I mentioned earlier, right, B2Brain works at the level of each salesperson's each target account. Okay, so if you are, each of you have like 50 accounts that you're working with this quarter or, you know, this month, it works uniquely for each one of you. Okay, but then what happens is in any company's sales funnel, accounts transfer from the top of the funnel to middle to the bottom. So it goes from the SDR to account executive to account manager. Okay, so when the account is getting transferred from the SDR to account executive, they will pass along intelligence and insights they had gained out of B2Brain with the account executive. Now the account executive will get curious and say, hey, how did you get this piece, this bit of information? Because they also have to continue the conversation, right? Like Venkat mentioned, 17 mails. Okay. It is just that it's broken into, you know, 8 mails by the first person and 5 mails by the second person and 4 by the third person. That's all. But that 17 number still holds. So when the transfer would happen, they will ask, oh, how did you get this intel? Then this guy will say, you know what, I use B2Brain. Then the AE will go to their manager and say, you know what, the SDR team is using B2Brain and they find it valuable, we should also get it. Okay, so that sort of, so to say, a very data-led network effect started appearing. Okay, so in a way, our go-to-market today is a combination of bottom-up adoption and product-led network effect within the company. Right, we see that, and that can, in effect, what we are saying is, to enter a company, I don't have to necessarily make the sales barrier one of selling to the management, because that comes with its own process, cost, cycle times, buying, and everything else. Okay, make the value realized by somebody within like 24 to 48 hours of sampling the product. Once they do that, there is an inherent pull within the product for other people in the team to use it, because the product works along the life cycle of an account within your sales funnel. Right, so that's the way we think about the problem. So, and coming back to where we focus, we said if we have to sell to somebody, they must at least appreciate that they have this problem of account research. Okay, and they'll not do it until they have at least 5 to 6 people doing outbound sales in their sales team. Okay, which means you will only have 5 to 6 people in your outbound sales if you're selling B2B and you're at least like a 75-80 people company. You'll not have, like, structurally, you may not have more than that number of people until you hit that, you know, 80 to 100 people mark. Okay, which means unless your company is at least 100 people in size and growing and adding to sales team, we don't think you are necessarily going to feel the pain of what we are solving for. So there were some structural factors which pushed us to saying, look, make sure you are focusing on your market where you're strong and, you know, play there. That's been our evolution. So which means we are selling mid-market and enterprise, and we are looking at value delivery within the first 24, 48 hours. And we are looking at product-led network effects within the company in order to scale the account.
Interesting. I think this, you know, there's a recurring theme, at least on this, on the mid-market side, if not yet on the enterprise, but maybe even on the enterprise side, to say, you know, product-led network effect of sorts, right? One thing feeds into another and the other team starts using it. That is very interesting, right? I'll change tracks a little bit. Something that we've observed is, again, which maybe comes from the plethora of tools that are available out there, right? And sales teams on an average, I'm assuming, just like any regular company as a whole using more SaaS tools, sales teams are also using more SaaS tools, right? I just want to understand, this means, how does this impact startups when they have in this domain, when they have to start off from a integrations standpoint, right? It seems to be that everybody has to have a very strong integrations piece, right? On the product side, right? You have to integrate with so many sides and so many tools on so many sides, right? So that the best experience is provided and so that you can have coverage of the market also. I'm just curious to understand, this seems to be, you know, a tedious effort, a continuous effort. How do you guys see this, you know, product integrations for your core with so many parts of the rest of the ecosystem, right? Do you want to go first?
That might be a startup idea all by itself. But I think, yeah, I think it's definitely hard, and sometimes that's a part of the differentiation strategy that one might also pick, right? So if you're looking, you know, if you're in a slightly more competitive space, if you're looking to find a different segment to focus on, a segment might no longer just get defined based on the size of the teams or, you know, the segment or the industry, but might get defined based on the tech stack that they use. Right. So suppose I chose that, you know, Salesforce, everybody builds for Salesforce. Let me go and focus on some of the other CRMs in which there aren't as many players in the ecosystem. Right. And that's. something that is less competitive. And that's not going to maybe give you a prolonged differentiation, but that might give you a good initial segment to focus on. Because then it's also possible to build and to tap into the communities around that tech stack, right? So some parts of the tech stack are in itself communities, right? Like, so CRMs have their own platforms, like Pipedrive has a pretty active community, and then so things like that. So I think that is one way to decide, right? Do I, if I'm anyways looking for a segment which is, say, smaller teams, then do I, you know, go a little bit less traditional and focus on some CRMs that might be supporting those teams and use that as my launch pad. Right, and we've all suffered from this. There are a bunch of integrations that we did and that we no longer maintain because, you know, we don't no longer see as much demand for them, and we've, you know, taken the conscious call of saying, sorry, we no longer support this, so too bad, right? So I think that's another thing to remember, that the initial cost when you're building out an integration might seem not that high, but maintaining that integration over a period of time, and trust me, every integration requires maintenance, right? It's quite high. So I would say that, yeah, there are two parts to it, right? One is think strategically and think of it as part of your go-to-market. And two is think of the overall cost, not just the initial cost, right? And therefore, when you're having those customer discussions where your salesperson wants to sell to someone only if it were for that integration, right? Take a view which is not just based on how that product is doing today, but do you think that product is going to continue to grow in the future, right? So sometimes we might choose not to integrate with a product like WebEx, for example, right? We know that it's been a good product in the past, but maybe that's not the product that we most come across with our target audience, and we know that maybe it's not the fastest growing product out there, right? Versus maybe Microsoft Teams wasn't something that people were talking about that much 18 months back, but you know, we've chosen to integrate with it because we see that growing.
Understood. Anybody else? Venkat, do you deal with that level of complexity on integrations, similar, more or less?
A lot more, actually. I would say, you know, I have a very strong view on this, which is integrations has been one of our major, major differentiators. Okay, and if you, I don't think Clenty would be where it is today without the integrations that we built, right? It really helped us. You know, but the good news for salespeople, okay, is that you don't, you know, while there are a variety of, you know, categories, subcategories within sales, the integration that really matters is your CRM integration. You know, you don't need to do all the integrations because everybody, you know, everything can flow via the CRM into other tools, right? So I don't need to integrate, for example, directly with the Strings.ai. It can go into the CRM and from there it can go to Strings. But as long as everybody integrates well with the CRM, you know, the system works well and the customer gets value. So while there is a profusion of tools, I think CRM integration is more important than any other category of integration to start with. Now, CRM choice of CRM integration actually determines your positioning in the market or your customer. You see, if you see the, you know, I can tell the maturity of a customer by knowing what CRM he uses. You know, in earliest days when somebody used to ask me to define my, you know, ICP and so on, I would actually start by saying this is the CRM that they use. Okay, because for me, when I knew what CRM the customer was using, I would know, is he an enterprise? Is he a guy who cares about security? Is he a guy who cares about usability? Is he a guy who cares about price? You know, I get a lot of thought, you know, view on that person. So, and the good news when we started building was, you know, competition was heavily focused on the Salesforce ecosystem. So we built a lot of the non-Salesforce integrations, you know, and that's how we got started. And, you know, we think of CRMs as not just, you know, not just customer value, but a strong, you know, marketing channel, actually, right? And so the CRMs promote you because you are plugging a certain gap in their product portfolio. And so they promote you. Some of the smaller upcoming CRMs really, you know, promote the partners and, because, for example, take a CRM like Pipedrive, their salespeople know our product in and out, their support people know our product in and out. So when there is a question asked to them, they would tell the customer, hey, this is the product you should use Clenty to solve this problem because we don't solve that problem right now. and so on. So it's been a good, you know, so we work with HubSpot, with, you know, Zoho, with FreshSales, you know, PipeDrive. So we build multiple CRM integrations. We have, and we think of that as an investment. We have a team dedicated to maintaining it, building it, and getting, making it stronger and stronger. And it's just the cost of this thing. On the flip side, obviously, every hour you spend working on the CRM integration, you're not working on increasing the depth of the core product, right? So CRM is a, is a breadth issue, not a, depth in the core product. So obviously, you want to have sufficient number of people focused on, getting depth into the core problem that you solve. And CRM is more a differentiator, but then I think it's a well-spent, effort for, the way we have built it.
Very valuable. Sridhar, anything to add there? And I want to go take that from there, because Venkat mentioned positioning, right? From there, I want to segment into, positioning, super crowded. We all spoke about it right at the top. How do you define what you solve, where you solve, who you solve for, stage you solve for, maybe segue into that also, going from your views on integration, if anything additional.
Yeah. So I think the point Venkat made about CRM to be looked at as a strategic investment, and what Shruti made about it's part of your go-to-market, is actually very valid. Okay. We don't live in a world where it's like one or two software. We're all parts of some jigsaw our customers are putting together. Okay, so it's important to interface with a bunch of different software that can be, very irregularly connected with ours. Okay, so one thing that we did, which in retrospect seems to have worked out for the use case that we are working on, is that we said we'll integrate, but our integration will be via REST APIs and via Google Chrome browser plugin. Okay, so very quickly, we could actually put together the B2Brain plugin that is on the Chrome store. And when you connect install the plugin and connect to one of your CRMs, today we support like Salesforce, HubSpot, Freshworks, and we also support Outreach and Salesloft. It just uses the OAuth APIs of those products. So at an individual level, you could actually sign into your product and connect that to your B2Brain instance. Okay. And what it also enabled us was to circumvent the whole enterprise process of integration, like all the heavy reviews that have to happen before a product is installed for everybody and so on, right? So it gave us speed and time to market, and also quick validation of the use case, because ultimately the value is in somebody getting value from us in their workflow. The value is not in somebody coming to our website and using us, right? A Google search is a Google search, whether you get it in your mobile or your desktop or in your inbox. Okay, similar to that. I'm a salesperson. I'm looking at an account. I want to know what's going on in the account. You give me that information wherever I am. That's the thought somebody has. So that, in retrospect, proved useful for us in terms of time to market. At the same time, we also realized that if you want to play the larger game, if you want to be a lot more accepted in the larger Salesforce ecosystem, because several mid-market companies, if you are growing and you're adding more than 25, 30 people, and you know your sales team is growing faster and your revenue is growing faster, you will have some sort of a executive level push to set up Salesforce. Okay, simply because it just seems to be a lot more recognized and accepted. Like people say, hey, nobody got fired for buying IBM. It's kind of that sort of a positioning they have, which means if we have to play the game with the enterprises, having a presence on the Salesforce App Exchange is a crucial thing for us. So we actually invested in building out the B2Brain native integration for Salesforce, and we got listed on the App Exchange a couple of weeks ago. Okay, which seems interesting because now it's helpful that we have put in all those efforts into integration. Now, when somebody wants to adopt us, it's very easy for them. We can just say, like, what is the Chrome store for a large portion of the market that we are going after? The equivalent is the Salesforce App Exchange for the Salesforce customers, right? Because you're a sales ops person, and sales ops and RevOps are like fantastically growing job roles and positions in companies today, right? RevOps, there's a huge amount of conversation around RevOps. Lots of sales is getting specialized. And when these people look at your listing on the Salesforce App Exchange, they kind of tick off the credibility point. Okay, you guys must be credible because you're listed here, kind of a thing. Right. So I believe that. So from that market stand, and I'm again not talking like the hundred thousand people employee enterprise here. I'm talking a company that's in the early thousands, for example, right? Where they have a dedicated RevOps and a sales ops team, or like even 500, 600 people plus, you will likely have like very focused sales operations teams. You need those teams to maintain that the efficiency of the sales team, right? They're like in the Indian IPL, in the cricket team, right? You have these physios and everybody else, the people who keep the, you know, playing 11 in top-notch form. It's that team. So if your company has got those functions already established, then you expect the sales teams to work at a certain level of efficiency, right? Which means you want to provide them a tool stack that is very reliable and functions the way it is expected to. Okay, and if we have to be present and accepted within that, we have to be present in the world that they play in and the world they look at. So it kind of comes back as, you know, as part of the positioning and as part of the go-to-market, it's important to, at least we are learning in the process, it's important to be present where you want your customers to build a perception of you. Right? Your website, of course, is a great place to build your positioning, but, you know, your customers form a perception of you and prospects at multiple places. Right? So we'll have to, like Venkat mentioned, in the Pipedrive world, I mean, it's amazing to hear that the Pipedrive salespeople recognize and refer Clienty. That's a non-trivial accomplishment, I would say. Right? That's a kind of positioning. Like somebody who can, they're literally, I mean, you're sitting on top of the CRM and somebody in the platform layer is selling you, nothing better. Right.
Interesting. Very interesting. Shudeep, one positioning, second competition, and particularly to say build from India with so much competition in all these segments from global players, American players with so much capital, right? That question pops up often. How do you think of that challenge, right? Is there, you know, there seemingly is a large enough playing field, right? Is that the positive way to look at it? Or, you know, does that open up something because they are too large or because they are in that geography? Just talk us through a little bit of your experience and your thinking on positioning your org, your business, and global competition. How do you tackle global competition? Think about it at least.
Yeah. I think, you know, irrespective of what you sell and who you're selling to, whether that's your employees, investors, or customers, right, that the question comes up. And I think the way to answer that question, and it kind of evolved over a period of time, right, is to think of it as a point of view, right? It's not about a particular segment. It's not about a price point. It's not about a feature set. Right, what is going to be overall the thing that's going to help you define yourself is that point of view, right, which is which can very well be different from you know, how a competitor views the market, right, because of the information that they have versus you have, and you know, just because of the path that you have chosen. And it's not about a right answer versus the wrong answer, right? So it's also a good way to be respectful of what somebody else is building, right, without, you know, kind of, without being able to talk clearly about yourself. So I think that's the way we think about this today. So when, if in our space, just for everyone's context, right, the large competitors are Gong and Chorus, both are, you know, at least one of them is definitely a unicorn, right? And so, of course, there is definitely a lot of positive to having a large competitor in your market, right? Because then they have lots of money and bandwidth to educate the market about it when it's a new product. The struggle that you'll always have is that when somebody's coming to you as an inbound lead, you're very often educating them not on the value that the product brings, but how you're different from that market leader. And so the point of view that we adopt in this specific case is that, you know, yes, going back to the helping you automate capture of information is great. Helping you analyze that information is also great. But if nobody's acting on that information, it eventually doesn't help your team close more deals, right? And so our point of view is to build something that is not just meant for managers, but for the entire sales team, because that's where the action is, right? The manager is now going to write the next email or make the next phone call to the prospect. It's the rep who's going to have to do that. And if you're not able to enable the rep to do that better, then while you might have much better visibility, you might have much better exposure to your pipeline forecast, but you're not going to actually be able to make a difference to the performance. So that's kind of how we think of the point of view. And so I would say that there are different ways to slice and dice this, right? And a lot of times people slice and dice it. And we've seen some of those things here today. One is based on team size. One is based on industry. Another is based on the tech stack. But one more important one is who's the primary persona, right? In Sridhar's case, like, you know, it's CSDR. So, you know, you could even focus on a B2C to B as a go-to-market approach. You know, in some cases, you might choose the sales enablement as your primary persona, right? In our case, you know, what we want to focus on is to say that this is meant to be that assistant for different roles in the team. And this is how it does it for different people. So I think there are different ways to think about the positioning and to be very mindful of the fact that each choice that you make is going to be a choice is going to impact your positioning.
Got it. Relevant. Venkat, I'm going to bring you in as a neutral sort of a observer to this craziness in terms of capital raise and valuations, which at least from my vantage point, I'm thinking you're not worried about, right? Or maybe not today, maybe later, we don't know, right? But your thoughts on what's happening, why is this happening, right? And headline views on that, right?
So what's happening in terms of the funding in the space, you mean? Or
how do you view it as a neutral guy? Why is there so much capital coming in? Does that mean, is that good thing, right? Is that a bad thing for the ecosystem in some sense, right? How do you kind of keep your mind decluttered from all that is going on, given that you're bootstrapped and not looking to raise capital? Right. And correct me if I'm wrong also.
No, totally. So, I think not raising capital gives you a lot of advantages. So we just said, hey, there are a lot of advantages of not having that, pressure and capital and so on. And so we just stuck to our strengths. But overall, if you ask me, I think capital coming into the space is actually quite good. So today the space is quite competitive, that we operate in sales engagement, tons of players, people getting funded and all of that. But in spite of that, and every time there's a new player coming in, et cetera, we only see the growth rates going up. You only see the momentum increasing. We don't see momentum decreasing because of that. So I think more people coming in, it just looks like it ups the game for everybody and, makes the world a lot more competitive. But I think we have not seen, that competition has led to a slowdown in the business or a slowdown or any of those things. I think it just creates, at least till now, so far, we haven't seen that as a negative thing so far at all.
US front, any thoughts on that, building from here with so much global competition, right? Of course, there's a slew of companies coming out of India itself, right? But if you had to say, what is the difference, what do you observe, right, that are global companies or American companies, let us say, just keep it simple, as opposed to Indian companies targeting the same customer, building a similar sort of product line?
So one of the things that we have really, leveraged on is being in India, we actually, we are able to offer a much higher quality of support to the SMB segment, compared to anybody else. I think a lot of the customers that we get are just simply delighted by the, level of support that we're able to offer. And we just, we're proud to invest more into it and so on. So whether it's Europe, or USA, we have full coverage in, a lot of these time zones, India, so multiple time zones, we have people, covering. We have engineers available on these, time zones. We have other support people available. And that is something that is truly a differentiator that only, can be provided from India. it's very tough to provide, you know, for in the Western markets, and you'll just play to that strength as well from here. And because our, you know, our GTM motion is also very, you know, product led or, you know, this thing. So our support actually doubles up as sales, right? So when somebody signs up for a free trial, they get good support and we help them onboard and set up the account very well. That naturally translates into, you know, better sales and better customer stickiness and so on. So I think there are advantages that one can use, and we have not found any disadvantage to being, you know, to playing from in India anywhere, right?
Got it. Got it. Just one quick question for all of you in terms of talking about companies that you may look up to and say you want to emulate and build like, right? Could be in your ecosystem, in and around your ecosystem, could be competition for all we know, right? Just throw, you know, one name and, you know, quick 1 minute about why you're super excited by learning from some of them and watching them. Venkat, maybe you start off.
Sure. The company / CEO who I most closely follow is, you know, Drift. I think they do a top-notch game when it comes to marketing, and, you know, the CEO is very, you know, marketing-driven, you know, company. And I, you know, love learning marketing from, very interesting how they came quite late in a space which is already quite crowded, and, you know, where Intercom had established itself as very, you know, credible name, and they were able to start late but really accelerate and, you know, establish themselves. So there's a lot of learning that I take from them.
Lovely, Shruti.
I'm still thinking. That's a tough one.
See that? Okay.
So there are actually several. It's kind of difficult to boil down to few, but I have basically drawn inspiration from different companies on different facets, and the three that kind of are top of mind are Google, LinkedIn, and Tesla. Okay, Google because and Google and LinkedIn are in some way the the ultimate guys that we want to go after. Okay, obviously in the path it'll be several others. Okay, because we are essentially solving a problem that will displace your usage of both those if we were to work really, really well in your world, right? So therefore they've already gotten to that place, so it's inspiring. Tesla was because, you know, the seamlessness with which they thought about the problem, right? They've kind of obfuscated all the complexity from the user and like made you have a perception that, you know, things go on smooth. All you need is find a way to charge my car or give me electricity and I'll take care of everything else, kind of a thing, right? So I would say that's clearly an inspiration. Okay, I had a couple of opportunities to go in, you know, two different friends is Tesla, one in the hands-free mode and all that stuff, and it's incredible the way they've thought through like the various touch points and like literally pushed away all the complexity from your view, right? So yeah, that's the three.
Yeah, interesting to see. In general, of course, inspiring a lot of businesses and business leaders, right, including yourself. Shruti, anyone comes to mind?
Yeah, I would say, I mean, Superhuman is one of them, right? And I think that what they have done really well, and now in some sense what Clubhouse is doing quite well as well, is creating, I don't know to what extent artificial, but some sort of a backlog, right, of demand. And using that almost to their advantage, right, where people are now like, hey, can you get me an invite, right? That's a very different strategy because literally in the cloud world, you know, scaling up infrastructure to support more people isn't an issue, right? So it's clearly a thought out marketing strategy and it's paid off well. There are definitely several other elements that go with it, right? So they've done it not just as a marketing ploy, but as a way to also gather much more information to be able to be much better informed about the way they build out their product roadmap. I think it's quite a good case study for people, especially who are focusing on PLG.
Nice, interesting. Somewhere along the way, I caught a consistent theme of saying, you know, interesting approach to messaging to the customer, user, marketing, and of course, the product itself, right? All three of your answers had some flavor of that, which makes so much sense in today's day and age. Right? We're at the you know, past the top hour mark. So we'll a few questions. There's one question, Akshay from Hippo Video, actually asking views on sales operations, sales ops as a function, and key factors on how sales ops can optimize the sales process. Sridhar had some very interesting analogy there, but I'll open it up to the others too to comment further, right? Because Sridhar, I think you already spoke a little bit about sales ops, but that was a very good analogy. I'll pick that up, right? Sales ops.
So, you know, I think the function of sales ops has changed dramatically, right? And I recently read this post on LinkedIn where they said, you know, a new sales ops person, if the manager asked for a report, they would go to the CRM, create a report and download it and post it. You know, the second level sales ops person would go ahead, create the report on the CRM, mail a link to that report, and also some instructions on how they could, you know, modify it or keep it updated, right? And the third level of a sales ops person, what they would do is they would actually go back and ask questions about what the business requirement was, right? Try to understand the business context a little bit better, and then try to understand, you know, where that data resided, what would make sense, and provide you not just with the report, but also with the caveats of what kind of inaccuracies and limitations that report might have. So I think that broadly, sales ops is, you know, in some sense, the quarterback or the wicketkeeper of the whole sales team, right? They have the best view, they are neutral, and they have a lot of the tools and come with the skill set to be able to make the most sense of what they see. So it can be a truly powerful role. I think it's just evolving, and it used to be considered, I think, a much more restricted role where it was just supposed to be somebody who was an expert at Salesforce, right? It was supposed to be more like a Salesforce admin. And I remember the first sales ops person that I encountered, right? Their role was literally to say that, okay, if you wanted this, if you want this information, and if it doesn't exist in Salesforce today, I will go and create a new custom field for you. And then, you know, in a month you would have it. And then after 6 months of this nonsense, when we ran the Salesforce report, we had, you know, 97% of the fields in the CRM, which had less than, which, you know, were not populated or had like less than 5% of entries, which had some notes on it. So I think it can quickly get pretty overwhelming if it's not done right. So yeah, in some sense, it's the break.
Yeah, nice. How sales ops has become important. Venkat, your thoughts? How are you? Do you have a team that is focused on that yourself? And just your thoughts on that.
No, absolutely. So I think I agree with you know, a lot of what Shruti said. Plus, I think a lot of it is also driven by the number of tools that a sales team is today juggling with. You think of the explosion of tools and this thing, it becomes very tough to get consistent data across the entire, you know, we struggle with it every single day, in spite of, you know, we've invested in sales ops, et cetera, but still consistency of data across, you know, marketing to sales to within sales itself, and, you know, and the number of tools that people are using, it's a constant, you know, challenge today. And I think something that it will hopefully get solved over the next few years.
Got it. There's one more question there, talking about customer churn, right? What top reasons do you guys see as, you know, why people leave, right? In your own experience for your company, what are you observing, right? And what do you think breaks customer experience that leads to churn, right? Just a quick couple of minutes from each of you on customer churn and reasons for that. Sridhar, you want to start? Painful lessons.
So I mean, we've been in the market for very few years, I would say, and therefore I'm going to talk with limited data and a bit of judgment / hypothesis. Okay. So it seems that the two big reasons why we have seen customer churn happen in some of the instances that have taken place are, one, either your product was not suitable for them, okay, which means your product did its work, but it did not, you know, suit the need of the customer. Okay, and which is a very common thing in early stage of a company, because you know initially you're looking at like every as long as the dollar is green, I'll take it kind of a, that's the mindset with which you go to the market, right? The second is that the customer force fitted or tried to have a even though you or so, okay, let me take a step back. First is the product did not suit the customer, even though the product did what it did, what it had to do. Second is your product did not do its job. Okay, you probably brought in the customer with a certain kind of expectation and a certain kind of, you know, what to see from it and so on. But obviously the customer has a different metric by which they measure. They are looking at it as, should I invest in this product because it will solve X for me? You're looking at it as, you know, will they sign the paper today because you have told everything that is to be said about the product and they seem to be willing to spend the money on you. Okay, so in some way, if that mismatch doesn't exist, then the only reason somebody will churn is because there is a better product than you. Otherwise, I kind of look at the churn as, you know, the two learning for me is a misfit between the product focus and the customer problem. And second is non-performance of the product itself. Say bad code, bad data, bad whatever. Something didn't work. Okay. Those are two reasons why, at least in my experience, in whatever instances that we've had when we went back and spoke to the customer and tried to learn, basically, you know, these are the two things that we've learned. But again, it's caveat with the fact that it's limited data. So, but sure, that's something we think about.
Got it.
I think just adding to that, maybe one thing that's kind of well known, right, is that your customer churn numbers are different, right, are much higher in SMB, lower in mid-market, and lowest in enterprise. That comes from two reasons. One is the friction for a large company to switch is very high. The friction for them to adopt something new is high. And if you went through a lot of scrutiny, you can imagine that the next player also needs to go through that level of scrutiny and adoption and all of that. And the second part of it is that the chance that a small company will go out of business over a 12-month period in itself is pretty high, right? Which is, of course, much, much, much lower for an enterprise company. So I think that's one thing to keep in mind when you're thinking about also what are your benchmark churn rates and whether you're okay with that churn or not, right? So if you're operating in SMB, then you can almost be sure that your churn rate is going to be, much higher and, you know, kind of factor that in as you build for your growth plans. And we've seen that too. So we've seen companies which, effectively either went out of business or came very close to going out of business through the pandemic period and therefore, churned away. Right. So that's definitely one part of it. And in some sense, that doesn't make you feel so bad because you at least know that wasn't your fault. but I think, yeah, the other type of churn is, sometimes it's not just about them not being a good fit, right? That also happens, right? Where you knew from day one that maybe they were not a good fit, any dollar is green, you took it up. But there are also instances where they were maybe a good fit when you brought them on board, but along the way, things change. And there the question is, those are some of the trends to really watch out for because you want to know who is in some sense outgrowing you, right? And is that the right type of segment that you're okay to be outgrown by, or is that the segment who you want to continue to support and therefore you need to change things? So I think that's maybe another segment of churn and that's probably a more meaningful one too.
Yeah, Venkat.
Yeah, so, always like Shuku mentioned, we are on the SMB side of the things. And so, about a year back, I must have spent a lot of time looking at, churn, looking at every single customer churn and reasons and doing a lot of analysis. Eventually, sort of the conclusion I sort of came to was, it's like this Anna Karenina quote, right? Every unhappy family is unhappy for its own reason. So, every churning customer churns for their own reasons, right? So, but then, I think there are a lot of lessons to be learned by looking at the people who are staying and who are growing with you. And in sort of the conclusion more was, focus on the ICP. So it's more about customer selection, right? And you know, if you are able to define a customer, you know, sort of model, who you think will get the maximum value from your product and has the least chance of churning, and then focus on that. That automatically actually translated to a lot of downstream benefits in terms of them expanding and churn actually automatically going down. So that's where our actually big turnaround was.
Yeah, I kind of heard the same thing at the back end from Shruti and yourself, right? If you pick why you're churning and don't want to focus on those sets, you become better. You're focusing on those ones that are working for you. And if you're outgrowing them or they're outgrowing you and you don't want that, then figure that out. Some sense. Makes sense. Another question on the platform, which is very relevant, I think, because of the audience and where we are, which is, should you sell first in India to refine your product offering if you're planning to build a global company and your mother market is in North America? Or just because selling in US is very different than in India, should go global from day one? Question is from Narayan Srinivasan, you know, who's just started his latest company as well. Some of you may know him already, Srini, right? You know, thoughts on that? All of you, as far as I understand, focusing on the North American market is my assumption and understanding currently, right? So just want to get feedback.
Can I give a one-liner response?
Please.
Yeah, I think if you're going after North America, cut all distractions, just go after that. It doesn't make sense because the games are different. It's a difference between IPL and NFL.
Actually, reference in there. Venkat?
I would argue it's actually easier to sell in the US than to sell in India. And for that precise reason, you should go to the US. Okay. Like first 5-10, I remember going, you know, visiting companies in India, showing them the product, etc. And it was so much tougher to sell. Whereas first customer who bought from us from outside the country was so simple, so easy, self-serve. He signed up, he put in his credit card. Next day morning, he woke up and he was there. Right. And I think and it's a recurring pattern. It's a lot easier to sell compared to, you know, we think we're not ready. I always kept thinking I should first find some Indian customers, make them happy, then go to the US and all of that. Reality was it was so much easier. If your product is still not ready, they will still be more forgiving compared to the Indian customer, who's a lot more demanding, I would say. So I would say the other way around.
Concur, Shruti?
Totally agree.
Simple. Okay. Great. I think we're kind of out of questions. Maybe I'll leave with a parting question for everybody, you know, to talk about wish list, thinking of what's going to happen next few years in your view, ecosystem. What would you like to see happen? Ecosystem and what equally for your own company, right? We'll end with that. Shruti, you'll start.
Sure. So I think the way the ecosystem is going to evolve is two things. One is, I think the tech stack is going to continue to expand, believe it or not. I think everybody already feels it's very bloated, but I think Sridhar has a great insight there, which is that it's going to get split up into individual tech stacks and company tech stacks, and therefore there's probably more room to play. So that's one part of it. I think the second part of it is, you know, a lot of the focus so far has been on, you know, building things around the CRM, and the primary layer has continued to be the CRM. You know, maybe this is somewhat wishful thinking, but it would be great to see somebody displace the CRM as that underlying layer in some sense. And yeah, I think that in a lot of ways, I think we are poised for that disruption. Would love to see that happen as well.
Yeah, that'll be exciting. Others, Sridhar?
So, yeah, the stuff about tech stack, etc. I look at things from a slightly different vantage point. And to me, as far as the ecosystem and the evolution is concerned, I think we have seen several startups come that have built businesses that are credible and growing and stuff. I think one area where I'd love to see and learn from and hopefully emulate or do better is in the whole area of storytelling and distribution. Okay, that's probably maybe because of the nature and stage of our company, but that's like the top thing on my mind, right? We have fantastic talent that's building products, great engineers, no problem, getting things out, like Venkat mentioned, amazing support, customers love it, all of that's great. But Venkat's example was Drift CEO, David Cancel. Now we should be okay. Okay. So the thing is, and my examples were Tesla and Google and LinkedIn. Right? So the thing is, you know, nowadays there are more companies that think of Freshworks, Zoho, Chargebee, Kissflow, all of these guys as inspirations, right? What does it take to build several more companies that are storied brands, storied B2B brands? Should be possible, right? So that's really where I'm excited about.
Very relevant, very, very relevant and important for all of us here. You guys are doing that, and we need to see more of that and keep getting better. Venkat, last thoughts?
So yeah, I think to draw from what Sridhar was saying, I think it's completely true. So it's a pain that I personally felt, you know, which is, and how do we become students of good marketing, you know, positioning, you know, all of that is so much more nuanced. You know, I think we are still good in the lead generation side of marketing, right, which is running the ads and getting the sign up and all that. So the transactional lead generation side, still we have good talent. But when it comes to strategically positioning the company, thinking of, you know, the strategic narrative, how do you tell the story of the company and the change in the world and all of that? There's a lot more that I think we're still learning you know, as an ecosystem. But I think, you know, there are, you know, initiatives like SaaS Boomi, et cetera, where a lot of this knowledge is beginning shared and, you know, getting created. So, and I was recently part of this GrowthX and SaaS Boomi, where we got a lot of learnings from, you know, such initiatives. So definitely benefited. But overall, the other trend that I'm also very, you know, from an ecosystem point of view, very happy to see is, you know, the emergence of, you know, multiple, you know, for example, in sales tech itself, there are three people, you know, in this call today, and there are probably 10, 15 other companies. We're also, you know, like, you know, similarly developer tools, every single vertical, every single category, there are multiple Indian, you know, or India-based startups emerging. And there's a lot of common learning, you know, ecosystem benefit that comes out of, you know, attacking a, you know, common vertical or, you know, this thing together. And I think that will happen over the next few years where, you know, I will learn from Shruti, maybe we will build an integration, or, you know, me and Sridhar, we may work together on something. And, you know, these things, you know, because of proximity and all of that, you know, the chances of us growing together, you know, I think that sort of trend also will emerge as India becomes more depth in terms of number of, you know, players in every category.
No, absolutely. I think we're already starting to see that, and it should prosper from here, like you said, thanks to proximity and cultural similarity, if you may say so, right? And multiplication is bound to happen, right? We see that a little bit from our deal flow and all of that, right? And obviously the panel here today, right? Super, I think this was amazing. We'll wrap with that positive note that we'll have multiple unicorns, decacorns, Venkat, whether you care about that or not is not important, right? But let's say hundreds of millions of dollars in revenue coming out of this ecosystem, right, is what we're all looking forward to. Right. And I will thank all of you for spending your time here and the audience for some of the questions and for listening in. This was amazing. Some key insights and learning. And we put out the video and some notes later for everybody to take away from. Shruti, thank you so much. Sridhar, likewise. Venkat, likewise. Taking the time and congratulations on building. Right. And wish you guys all the best.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Shout out to all the audience. These guys are building some amazing stuff, great products. And a great company and great companies, right? Please write to them, reach out to them. I think most of them, all of them available on LinkedIn, Twitter, right? And on their website, you can work for them, you know, work with them, various forms and shapes. So shout out for that as well. They're all hiring, I'm sure.
Absolutely. Anytime.
Take care. Thank you so much, everyone.
Thanks, everyone. Bye-bye.
Over to you, Dhanush.